3:45, so we've got
half an hour. What, 35 minutes? Yeah. So we've got about 35 minutes, so I think we should just dive in. Go easy on us, and it's not really about us answering questions. It's more, I think, a conversation, and I would love to hear from you for some of your experiences or challenges or things that resonated with you. Or, you know, of course you can ask questions, but it would be very good for us to have a conversation. So anyone feeling dying to go first, we'll go on the front row here. You've got a microphone. Oh, we only got one?
Okay, people have to come up because it's on a wire. I'm an Anglican priest, and I would just like to say, I know that there are many women rabbis. I remember about 35 years ago, Rabbi Julia Neuberger, yes, was the first rabbi. And in the feminist movement, the voice of Muslim women have not been heard. They've been silent. But I just want to say it's great that people like you and the lovely Ramona, who was here yesterday, and Shalina Muhammad, who wrote the book, Love in a very humorous book called Love in a Headscarf, that it's great having Muslim women's voices in the feminist debate now. I think that's great.
Thank you.
Right, I'll pay her later. I told her to say that. No. Good way to start, though. She's been very generous. Okay, over here. You want to come up? So maybe anybody who has a comment or question or whatever, you're going to need to sort of start to make your way to the front, I guess. Sorry about that, but we've only got one microphone.
Thank you very much, and really nice to hear what you said. It's more, I'm a Christian. I'm not a priest. I'm married to a priest. I'm now 54, and I spent a long time just assuming and accepting what I was brought up with. And then at some point I realised there was something slightly odd about the fact that we didn't have women priests, and it took a while. And now, more recently, in the last 10 years, 5 years, I just think there is a problem with the way we talk about God. And I think that's really, really important. And I don't want to talk about God as he anymore. I really don't. Sorry. So, for some reason, it's making me really shake. And I just want to say some of the small things. So I went to a morning prayer, which I go to not irregularly, and I said, "Is it all right with you if I say she for God? I can't do he anymore." And they said, "Yes, you can." And so we did that for a while, a small group, and then they went, "This is awkward. Okay, let's try and sort it." So we then did, if you sat on the left, you said he, and if you sat on the right, you said she. And it was lovely, because there's one woman there who said, "Look, I'm 70, I can't do the she thing. But, you know, I'm happy for you two." And then I wrote an article about this, that I thought there's no reason why we can't mix pronouns. It doesn't have to be he or she, you can mix them. And then I ended up, I was doing a reading in church, and I looked at it. I wasn't planning to. It's because I promised that somebody would do it, and then I couldn't get anybody else to do it. And I actually had this crisis. It was ridiculous. This is just a reading in church. And I thought, I cannot read this reading, because it's all he. And then I thought, well, why don't you do what you said, which is say he and she? And then I thought, and then I went hot and cold all over. And then I got up in church, and I did it. And I felt really, really good, really good. And I think I had three comments. They were all positive, and I think I'm not sure anyone else noticed, to be honest. So I just really would just want to say that I just really encourage you to do the small things, and it's really frightening. For me, I've been brought up to obey, do you know what I mean, and not to cross the rules, and to actually do that and say, "I'm going to sing she, I'm sick of this." And it is incredibly empowering, rather than just being moany and miserable about it. Just get on and do it. And so all power to you.
Unless, and are you going to respond to that? Because it might be interesting to hear your perspectives. And anyway, I had two questions, but she got that one in, so that's good. My other question was, I guess maybe towards you, Julie, but I'd be interested as well, Rachel, to hear your perspectives. You know, after all these sort of, for me as a Christian, sort of looking at various different denominations, tackling this whole patriarchy thing and, you know, where women sit and how women lead and whether they lead at all and stuff. And I think I'm writing saying that there's a group of women, is it in Birmingham? Oh, Bradford, I think, who are looking at a women-only mosque. And part of me thought, oh, that's exciting. And part of me thought, oh, that's so sad. And I just wondered what you felt about that and, you know, where are there any other things with maybe in the more conservative, traditional, Orthodox Jewish communities looking at those issues?
I think there's one in Denmark. Yeah. Did you hear about that one?
Yeah, I did. No, I just want to commend the lady who spoke and got emotional, because we can all relate to that, because it's that's coming from the heart. That's why you got emotional. So I can completely relate to that. And my kids would say, oh, that would be you, Mum, if you were saying that. Oh, Mum, what are you crying for now? That kind of thing. So, you know, I'm with you on that. And, you know, good for you, because it's not easy. And it's one thing to do it in your head and another thing to do it in public. You did it here, but also there. So I think credit to you for that. So in answer to the question about mosque, and, you know, I was thinking of it actually as I was talking, so I'm glad you've asked me about women-only mosque, and is that the answer? And I'm kind of on the fence, which might seem a bit of a cop-out, but basically I feel like it's bound to happen, because if you push people far enough, that is what is going to happen. You're going to end up in a situation where people think, stuff this, we're going to do it ourselves. The consultation around that women-only the consultation around that project has also been interesting, and they've had to sort of think about it and move and change ideas. And of course, as Katrina said, there are women run mosques in other countries already. So I actually feel it's a really good thing that they're doing it, because I think it's part of the conversation. I don't necessarily think it's the answer, because I don't think there is one answer. So I think it's what Lucy Winkett said, that some of us need to stay in and some of us need to get out and do something else. And what it has done is created more of a conversation where people are almost thinking, oh my gosh, is that actually how people feel? And is that what's going to happen if we keep on doing this? Are women really going to do that? And we can't possibly have that happening. Can't possibly have women running things. I think it's part of that as well, to be honest, which is part of the whole problem in the first place. But I think, so it'll be interesting to see where they go. I hope they make it work, because it's hard. Hard because you need, as any of you know who've been involved in buildings and running things and stuff, that becomes like your big headache, the running of the actual thing itself. In America, they've done something interesting, which they're calling the Women's Mosque of America, which you can look up. I mean, America's huge, so of course it's just one small thing that's happening, but it's quite significant. And so they haven't got a building. It's a thing. It's a Friday prayers that they do. The woman leads the prayers. She does the sermon, and it's all women. And some of the feedback from those women has been amazing in the way that I would expect it to be, which was, it feels safe, it feels relevant, it feels that it talks to me, that I feel more comfortable than I ever have in a mosque, you know, that type of stuff. So those voices need to be heard as well, because people need to understand and hear, if women don't feel comfortable going into a place of worship, it's not a men's place of worship, it's God's house, for crying out loud. So if women don't feel comfortable going in there, something is massively wrong with that. And that, what I would say, is the same for all of the, any institution where someone, whether it be even, it doesn't necessarily, this isn't necessarily a men-women argument anyway, we're just focusing on that. I feel like there's lots of people, I could talk about mosques, people who are looking at their own sexuality, for example, also don't necessarily feel comfortable going into a mosque because they don't feel the space is safe for them to talk about who they are and what they're exploring. These things are really real and conversations that have to happen. So I think the long-winded answer, which is, I'm glad they're doing it, because it's going to force people to, and it is already forcing people to have the conversation. I don't think it's the answer, but I think it's a brilliant thing, and, you know, more power to them, really, for actually being brave. Because in Bradford, it's really loaded and politically, and it's all linked with all sorts of different groups of people, mainly male oriented with regards to local politics and things like that as well. So it's quite a challenging environment to people to step out of that and challenge it. I think, you know, is a brave thing to do. I just hope they can make it actually work, so that people then don't say, RC, that wasn't the right thing to do in the first place. You know, that's what I don't want to happen. I don't know if you've got any thoughts about.
Yeah, just to answer your, oh, sorry. To answer your question from a Jewish perspective, in Orthodox Judaism, yes, sort of. Basically, there's a concept called a minyan, which is a group of 10, traditionally, that will be male Jewish adults. And in order to say certain prayers or to have certain phrases within them, you can't start that without the minyan being present. So you need to wait for at least 10 men to turn up. It wouldn't work to have a female minyan because the whole concept is, you know, do we need 10 adults of either gender or do we need actually 10 men? So a group of women praying isn't a minyan, and therefore they wouldn't be able to say those prayers in the same way that, you know, in, say, a Masorti context, 9 men and women together, well, you'll be waiting for a 10th person because that's not a minyan yet. However, there's certain contexts that this issue has cropped up in. There are female groups of Orthodox women for chanting psalms, which is like a practice that's quite common in Orthodox communities. There's also some Jewish festivals. You read a book in the Jewish Bible called a Megillah. So, for example, Megillat Esther is read on Purim. Some communities, Orthodox communities, will allow a woman to read the Megillah as a ritual act and fulfill that mitzvah, but only in front of other women, not in front of men and women mixed. There is one sort of quite alternative Orthodox community in Israel called Shira Chadashah that I've been to, and they have a really interesting dual service leading system where they have a mechitza and they have a woman leading the women's section and a man leading the men's section in parallel. And I think that's, I don't know if any of these setups would be relevant in a Muslim context, but I know they're there in the Jewish context. So, yeah.
Probably not for you, is it? Anyone else?
I just wanted to share my personal take in like feminism in religion and everything, because I'm a transgender person, and having the being a feminist and also growing up in a religious space with a Christian family, but also having a lot of friends of other religions and seeing that, and also other transgender friends who within their own faiths don't have a space where they can fully practice, and they can't pray or practice in the same way because a lot of their places of worship are so binary that they don't even feel able to go, and then feel very disenfranchised from their own families and pushed out of those communities. And I just wondered if anyone else had stories or anyone else had encountered that or thought of a way in which we can really sort of say more than just like welcoming women and empowering women is also saying that men and women aren't so different, and we should empower everyone to get involved in their churches and mosques and in religion in any way that they want to, and they should feel free to be able to worship and feel loved by those around them, whoever they are.
Would anybody like to respond to that? To any examples of where that is the case?
No. I mean, once again, I really appreciate you saying that, and it's brave of you to say it in its own way, because, you know, you never quite know what response. All I would say is that actually amongst Muslims in general, and particularly amongst clergy, if you like, it's shockingly bad. Let me just say it like that. Why? Because people haven't quite understood how to talk about this stuff and how to make people feel safe and welcome, whoever they are. That's why I touched on it earlier, that it isn't even necessarily a men-women thing, and you've said it much better than I could have done. Shockingly bad in terms of a bit like we are generally, or have been certainly, things are moving, but clearly lots of people with these kinds of challenges is still very difficult for them in society anyway, perhaps. And I feel like in religious spaces, it's harder because people are trying to work out what the scriptures say, where there's certain things that seem quite clear. Clearly there's context involved in that, and when it was revealed, it's very different to now. Our understanding of these issues is very different now, thank God. So I think it's bad because people haven't really understood how to have these conversations, and the more we can make people feel safe enough to speak about stuff, then the more we are going to talk about the issues. And, you know, people who are holding back or feeling that they need to be in a certain way and not being themselves, we need to make sure we open that up so that people can. So I want to say that things are going in the right direction. It's very, very slow. I think, you know, I speak to Jewish friends, maybe we can hear about some of that. And, you know, they've gone much further than we have in clearly in dealing with some of this stuff. At least allowing people to talk about things, but there's still challenges there. And clearly within the church, there are, because the Archbishop of Canterbury wouldn't have mentioned it at Greenbelt if there weren't issues. You know, he mentioned it. So, you know, there are, again, it's another set of issues that I think is, there are some commonalities in terms of the difficulty that I think we can sort of join together in the space when it comes to talking about it. But I really thank you for saying it as well.
Yeah, I think that was really brave. Yeah, thank you. One thing that I've noticed that works, I think, quite well in Jewish communities that I'm involved in is, for one thing, there's a Jewish organisation called Keshet, which is GLBTQ sort of education. I presume there are Christian alternatives that do similar things. And to actually sort of get hold of an organisation that can come and provide some hands-on education and maybe workshops in the community to sort of intervene, you know, now rather than when someone has had an upsetting experience and is upset about it and wants something to happen then. The other thing is that the Transgender Day of Remembrance can be a great opportunity to kind of draw awareness to those kind of issues and have some education. And I think a lot of people, they're not, you know, they don't come at it from a position of sort of hostility, but they are unfamiliar with the correct etiquette and they say stupid things. And that's really hurtful, because when you're in a minority, and I'm speaking as a Jew, obviously I'm not a trans person, I'm cisgendered. When you're in a minority, you don't always want to have to be somebody's learning experience because they've never met one of you before, and you know it's so exhausting. And yeah, so you know communities need to help their trans members by becoming educated and learning how to incorporate diversity rather than kind of leaving it on the shoulders of that individual.
I was just scratching my head and thinking, where in the Church of England are things just easing a bit more in the direction that you're hoping that they will go in? And I think there are some churches that are a bit more literate and understand and will welcome. But even things like, unlikely perhaps, sounds, St Paul's Cathedral in London. They have, I don't know if either of you have ever been to their a hate crime memorial event every year. I think it's in November. And what reminded me is when you said about the Transgender Memorial Day. And that's a very open and inclusive event. And I think Mark Oakley at Greenbelt this year? I think he is. And I think he's the guy who kind of leads that. And so there are, if you look hard, there are little green shoots of where things can be different and modelling different ways of being church. There's inclusive church as well. Yes. Yes. Yes, please.
Pick up partly on what the lady was saying there. Inclusive Church has got a whole sort of book range. One of them's on gender, one of them's on sexuality. And there's also resources in there. And also on the Christian side of things, there is a group called Sybils. If you've not come across them, Sybils is a good link. And again, they'll put you in touch. And they meet regularly in various places all over the country. So on transgender things, there are things. You know, one of the other things to try and do is actually have conversations with other people. And my wife has started a feminist theology group in the local pub. And she's got people attending it who are atheist, Buddhist, and all sorts of things. If it had been announced as a Bible study, she probably wouldn't have got people coming along. But because it's just, oh, we want to talk about feminist stuff, people are coming along and joining in the conversation, which is really important. Thank you, ladies.
Just on the same subject, to let you know that the Church of England is ordaining transgender people. Of course, there are some who are already ordained and transgender, but Ely, next Peter Tide, that's me.
Sorry, changing the topic completely, but while obviously we can't generalise and say all women this and all women that, I'd like to throw open really to the panel and to everybody else. What do you think are the particular strengths that women in faith traditions can bring both to their faith tradition and also to the feminist movement? Because for me, I think what I notice is perhaps because you spend a lot of time in committees, you learn to be collaborative and you try and rather than competitive. That for me is a strength that I've learned from my religious background. But I wondered what everyone else thought.
Just take a couple. Are you waiting to say something? We just take a couple more questions and then.
Sorry. Yeah, please. Why don't you go next?
A bloke to do this.
I just wanted to see if and it will reach. Thank you. I've found it really inspiring to have all of you up here talking, and I just wanted to know what you think is the best way we can all help and support each other across the different faith traditions so that we're not really insular and just looking within our own faiths all the time.
I'm Christian and my mum's a vicar, so I've grown up in quite a Christian environment, and I was kind of always raised to be a feminist, so it's, yeah, cool. Go my parents. But it's a bit like kind of not exactly starter feminism, exactly like, I'm not saying my parents aren't feminists, I'm saying I was kind of like the definition of feminism, that like kind of going into the deeper meanings of it, because I was quite young. So when I kind of started discovering the internet and went to high school, and now my two best friends are an Iraqi Muslim refugee and a Danish Muslim immigrant, it's like kind of that you get much more information than in the RE classes, when your teacher is basically banging her head on the desk because you've got some real students who really don't care and are just waiting for break, and you can just see her physically banging her head on the desk, but in her mind. So, but it's kind of like the internet to kind of taught me a lot more about feminism than I started understanding it more. It's like the internet's a weird place with lots of weird people with different ideas. So not everyone on the internet is a feminist, but you learn much more about feminism than through that. So how would you think of the internet as a medium for learning that?
Oh, good on you. Fantastic. So we had...
What strengths do we specifically have?
We have... What can we do together?
And how bad are our resources?
you heard that.
Meet people rather than... And also the internet.
Can I take this one? And I'll pass it on. I absolutely agree. I think it's good to be in solidarity, for all women to be in solidarity across. But I would also add in secular, atheist, humanist women as well, as because if you look at the secular world, actually it's not that much. But I don't think we need to beat ourselves up extraordinarily about within religious communities. You look at the academic life, look at all sorts of other things, and you see women struggling quite significantly. So I think, yeah, all women together.
Quick comment about the person who wanted to know whether women bring particular strengths. Yes, that's probably true in the aggregate. However, I'm very cautious about any kind of essentialism in gender, and I don't primarily think of myself as a woman. I think of myself as me, a human being. So, and you know, I try to see others like that too. And I think sometimes, for example, I've heard that argument with regards to something like women rabbis. People say, "Oh, it must be lovely to have a woman rabbi because you know, you'd be so comfortable talking to her, and I'm sure she's like super empathetic." And well, actually, like my synagogue has 5 rabbis, 4 of which are women. None of them are like that. So yeah.
Do you want to pick up on the other point, the thing about internet and also about what we can do together? What would you say about that?
As to what we can do together, I think interfaith dialogue, it can be done correctly, done intelligently, can be really powerful. And I mean, to me, like, feminism is just an issue about life and it comes into everything. So just, you know, working on social action together or doing scriptural reasoning or text study together, you know, feminism will feed into that if it's part of your worldview. You don't need to kind of box it off. But, you know, it's a good idea to have good, strong relationships with other faith communities in general. As for education, I totally understand what you mean. I didn't learn a lot in my formal schooling. I learned an awful lot on the internet. So, yeah, I'm with you on that one.
Yeah, I mean, I just wanted to pick up. I'm very jealous of you being able to hold your baby like that, by the way, because I can't do that with mine anymore. The youngest is 10, the oldest is 18. They wouldn't really appreciate me doing that with them anymore. But I used to love it. I think it's a really interesting question because the challenge when it comes to challenging stuff that's not going right when it comes to the genders, often what then happens is that when you want to do, for example, women-only stuff, people start to get a bit jittery. So I have Muslim friends who want to pursue this agenda more and start to explore stuff and question things. And then if you say, well, let's do a women-only thing, they kind of feel, well, that's almost going backwards. And I feel, I love women-only stuff. I love, because I think there's a strength between us and I think there are differences. And one of the things that comes up a lot amongst Muslims when it comes to this issue, and often it's used against people like me, but I think it can be a powerful way to explain the situation as well. It's not to say that men and women are the same. And actually, we don't have to all say that men and women are the same. And men and women are made differently, I believe, if that's what we're talking about here. Go back to the binary thing. There's a lot more complexity to it than that. But if that's what we're talking about right now, then I do think that women have and can have certain strengths. And we shouldn't feel ashamed to say it either. And, you know, if it is that you're in an environment where women are naturally looking after the children and want to stay home, we need to be able to celebrate that as well. So I feel like we shouldn't shut that stuff down just because we're trying to talk about equality or talk about the fact that women are not being treated well enough. I think it's a tricky one because I've experienced it myself. And in terms of what we can do together, I also think there is definitely a space, a very powerful space, for women of faith to do things together. You talk about humanists, etc., but I really feel that there's something quite powerful about people who live their life remembering God, and I think there's something extra powerful about women of faith. I'm actually co-chair of a Muslim and Jewish women's network. I know I'm in a Christian audience here. Still do all sorts of other work, of course, as well. I just say that. But the reason we've done this work, Muslim and Jewish women specifically, is because clearly the work that's supposedly been done for the last 30 years, even in this country, frankly, hasn't really worked. If most people still feel that a Muslim won't go into a synagogue or a Jew won't come into a mosque and there's a lot of animosity and every time something happens in the Middle East, it has an impact here, well, then clearly we need to try something else. And I've been amazed and blown away by the response that we've had from both Muslim and Jewish women who actually want to do it differently. And when we have a meeting or a get together, we very much build the whole thing on friendship and say to people, please do not put Israel at the heart of what you're doing. Actually park it, name it, say it's there. It is important. Israel and Palestine, of course, are important, but don't put it in the middle and then not deal with it properly. Build the friendships and build the trust. Now, you can do that better, I feel, with groups of women than you can clearly the way people have tried to do it before, because if you don't have the trust and the friendship as soon as something happens there or here, it breaks down straight away. And what we found is that women get together and have a meal and talk about kids and all of that, and you feel like you've known each other for years. It doesn't happen the same way necessarily with respect to all of my lovely brothers here, who it doesn't happen the same way. So I think there's something very powerful about taking on some of the issues of society as women of faith, but also challenging within our own faiths as well. Long answer, I know. And I would just say about the internet that actually there's good, there's really horrible stuff on the internet. Clearly women, I would argue, suffer more when it comes to social media and all of that stuff than men do. Kate Botley, the vicar that's here, that's on Gogglebox and all of that, that she was just saying to me that, you know, men just don't get the same response on social media, the stuff about, you know, that you're going to get raped and all of that that women do on social media. But the good part about social media that I feel is that you can connect with people and feel like you know them, and actually you've only ever known them in a virtual kind of sense. It's a brilliant thing. I can keep up with Catriona much better than I can in real, because she's in South London, I'm in West London, or I'm up north or whatever, because of the Facebook and that. So I think there's a brilliant connection that we can make and use it to our advantage. That's what I would say about that. I'm feeling bad because there's lots of people here. And what do we do now? So let's hear from you. Maybe make comments. I'm not sure that we'll be able to respond necessarily. But please, and
just as I'm passing the microphone, the Christian Muslim Forum that I work with has got young people in their, young women in their 20s, getting together on gender equality, a group. So if you're interested, let me know. Yeah.
Sorry.
So shall we just everybody have just quickly pass it?
Sorry, mine was a really quick comment on the conversation a little while ago about the about kind of gender issues. I'm a primary school teacher in Bradford. I teach year six children, and sexuality and gender is now on the curriculum. And I let the children vote in my class whether they prefer to talk about that together or whether they prefer to talk about it in separate sessions. They unanimously preferred to talk about it together because they said if we're looking at equality, that's something we need to do together. And the levels of acceptance, of kind of progressive thinking, of openness that I saw within those children, where most of them are Pakistani Muslims, there's also a few kind of Eastern Europeans and white British in there as well. The levels of openness I saw absolutely blew me away, and I think there's such a hope for the future. So.
So I was raised in a household where I had kind of the freedom to choose what religion I would have and what I would believe in. My dad's actually a vicar. He was newly ordained, and he's giving a service on Monday in the shelter, if you're interested. But what I was going to say, a little plug there, but what I was going to say is that I was raised to believe, it's not even a belief, it's a fact, that all humans are equal. And that men, women, black people, white people, whoever you are, you know, gay, straight, whatever, all humans are equal. And you shouldn't really even see feminism as a movement which is actually necessary, because the way that I see it is you're either a normal person, or what most people call a feminist, or a bigot. And I know that that might offend some, but that's kind of true, right? You know, I mean, you're either accepting towards people or you're just horrible, right? So that's just my two cents.
Thank you. Although we definitely do need feminism as a movement, and if you want to go for a pint after and talk about it, I can do that. But in other news, just very quickly, also just one comment is that maybe this is so urgent and there's so many people that we should have more hours of Greenbelt dedicated to it. And as a 50% of Greenbelt, I think maybe it's quite urgent and we should maybe next year, everybody give feedback to say that this shouldn't be just one session. Everyone's got so much to say, so I'll be very, very fast. In brief, I used to be a Christian and I was a Christian youth worker, and I used to bring teenagers here. And I feel like, ironically, the God that I got to know through my upbringing in Christianity, I got to feel that and know that so well that when I turned back to my religious text, I didn't see the same God that I'd got to know in the faces of everybody I'd loved in the community. And I think we've talked a lot about the culture and how we respond to religious cultures today. But I'd love to hear your thoughts on how you respond to the misogyny that you might see in the text that you read. Because I actually realised, listening to you guys, I was sitting right at the back, was that I think maybe I still return to Greenbelt, even though I don't consider myself a Christian, I consider myself agnostic, because I would like to reconcile myself with a religious text and still be able to call myself a feminist. But at the moment, I can't, and I'd love to hear any of your thoughts about how you do that, because I literally can't.
Yeah. Okay. We're going to listen to everybody first.
Hi, so I suppose I wanted to... I was a Christian. I'm not sure I'd say I was anymore, because I feel like I have kind of been driven from the church from being a woman and being bisexual and having mental health issues. And I think there's just a lot that we need to be calling out in the church urgently. I think it's not really acceptable to say it's going to take a long time. These things can cost lives. These things can cause suicide. Being driven out of the church is horrific. And simple things, just like gender norms that are being enforced, challenging women getting given all the emotional labour, getting given all the domestic labour. The pronouns thing, definitely with God, is something that I find a huge issue with. I forgot what I was going to say. So many things. I can't. I kind of have anxiety, so I find this really stressful. But feminism is really important. And...
I just want to say to you, have you come across a woman called Jan Berry? She's a URC theologian, and she does amazing liturgy that's from a female perspective, and it's just really, really powerful. It's worth looking her up. I want to say thank you so much for these conversations. Thank you, Julie, for instigating them. Really, really important. I came to Christianity quite late, sort of late in my 20s, having come from a background of being very, very into complementary health stuff. And even the sort of in the fairly progressive church that I joined, that was... I guess my experience is that complementary and alternative health tends to be something that more women are into. And it feels like one of the places that women are subjugated. Oh, that's all of the devil, don't you know? That's not Christian. And I've come to a place where actually I don't believe that at all. It's very much my experience. I've seen a homeopath all my life. I've managed complementary health centres. I'm a massage therapist. It's very much one of healing. And for me, any form of healing comes from God, no matter what. Or it's from, it's very sort of, yeah, light-filled stuff. We're still living with... in the church under this thing that we had in the Middle Ages of the witch burning stuff. We're still living under that. All the sort of healers and things of that time were women, and in order to sort of subjugate them, they were burnt. So yeah, I don't know where I'm going with this, but that's just what I wanted to say.
Hi, I'm 17, and I've identified as Christian pretty much my whole life, but in the last year I've been driven out of my church that I've been attending for, God, 7 years, 8 years. So in the last year I found it really hard to identify as Christian, and I'm really far away from that right now. And that is because I started to discover and explore the feminist ideas and feminist thoughts, and I have had a lot of really bad experiences with Christian ministers and my youth worker in particular, very forcefully telling me that I was wrong and using scripture to back him up. And I very often felt like I'm not capable enough to go, well, hold on a second, there's this bit of scripture that kind of disagrees. And how could you suggest any way to kind of go, okay, yeah, there's these really misogynistic sections within the Bible, but then how can I then argue against that without kind of completely saying, well, I don't believe the Bible at all? Like, does that make sense?
I hope I'm one of an emerging group of men of my generation who are completely and utterly fed up with the patriarchy and have been for a while. What I'd like to know is how we can contribute to this cause, because obviously there's a sensitivities around men coming in and taking over or something like that, but there are a lot of us who want to contribute and it's really important to us, and that'd be really helpful. Thanks.
We're over time, so definitely a bigger venue next time, and lots more of these opportunities, I think, to speak. I would just say, in relation to a number of the last questions, I'm a follower of Jesus. I look what Jesus did and who he met, who he spent time with, his idea of God, which was just huge, not that small one, and so I continue to follow Jesus.
Yeah, a couple of things. Misogyny in texts. Actually, I find text study really inspiring because, for one thing, I think when you go deep into the text, it's a lot more subversive and interesting than you might have been taught it is. The other thing is that texts come out of a historical and cultural context that isn't ours, so we had to respect and understand that, but it doesn't mean that we can't bring a modern perspective to them when we analyse them. And sort of, you know, there's certainly sexism in a lot of parts of the Hebrew Bible. I'm not comfortable with it, and I say that. And I think just be honest is a good thing in text study. Why is it necessary, you know, if you're not a feminist, aren't you just a bigot? It's totally necessary, and I think in some ways it's... I totally get why you said it like that, but thinking of it in that kind of binary way is actually quite dangerous because we are all part of society and we're all going to be a bit sexist and a bit racist and a bit homophobic and so on, and it's much more healthy to kind of understand and anticipate that and then judge yourself on those things in a kind way and try to improve, but sort of look at stuff like microaggressions, mansplaining, gender division of labour. A lot of that stuff is going on in so-called very progressive communities. So we absolutely need feminism and we need to keep focused on it. Men, what can you do about this problem? Understand privilege. Understand your own gender privilege. I do that. I'm white. I have white privilege. Before that was explained to me by non-white people, I didn't, you know, it was like an invisible backpack that I never had to look at, and I just got all this nice stuff coming to me for free, and I thought I was a great person, and, well, no, actually, I was privileged. So, we should all be looking at that.
Okay, so it's almost impossible to wrap up a session like this and do it justice, but I guess that's part of it. It leaves a lot of things hanging, and there's lots of questions that people have asked that I can't answer because we don't have time. I really appreciate your honesty for the people that talked, especially there at the end. I would say that God knows everything. And, you know, even the fact that you would say in a case like yours and others that you've left the church, or it could replace that word with mosque or whatever, it really is about how we continue to explore and discover how we can stay, if that's what we want to do. I would certainly recommend that everybody orders this book. And reads it, really, because a lot of the things that have been touched on, I'm not on commission, by the way, although I should be, a lot of the things that have been touched on today, people have said here, and sometimes that in itself is very reassuring, because you know you're not on your own. I think I'm very glad that I pitched this session to the director of Greenbelt, and I'm going to give him the feedback that it was a very good session, but that's really because of all of you, not really because necessarily of us. I think we just instigated something that was already there anyway. So I really appreciate your honesty and openness and giving us the space to do this, because I've learned a lot. And I think it's to be continued, really, not just at Greenbelt. I would say that people should, if they're in those areas where there are women from different backgrounds, to take it upon yourself to set up some sort of regular discussion group. You could base it on this book like I have today, or you can do it on other issues. But I can guarantee you that there are other women of faith, whatever that faith is, in your area, that will resonate with what you're saying, and you'll realise that you're not on your own and that we all have something that we can offer each other. I'm just going to finish with one paragraph, literally a couple of lines, because there's so many to choose from in here. So I'm going to let her have the last word. And she says this. I've been asked before why I stay in a religion that consistently relegates me to a second-class status, and my answer is simple. I shouldn't have to give up God and my faith community just because religious scholars have failed to recognise my innate worth in their interpretations of Islam / Christianity / Judaism. Does that make me stubborn? A troublemaker? So be it. I'm in good company. Thank you. Thank you. I think we all have to go now. Do we? I think we do.